bush.
How are you, sir?
This morning and leave the outside world just that, the world outside. We thank you for the chance to focus on you, Lord, to pray, to listen, and to hear. Help us, O Lord, to open our hearts, our eyes, and our minds, and help us, Lord, to see the beauty you show us every day. God, through Jesus, you made yourself known. Thank you for providing a way for us to know you deeply. When we struggle to hear you, please give us encouragement and guidance through your word. Amen. Amen. Opening hymn is number 431.
Thank you.
morning.
Good morning.
Terry reminded me as we walked in the door this morning how beautiful the green fields of wheat look this time of year. It is something to be thankful for. So if you're new to the church, we have restrooms in the back hallway behind these doors here. We have, of course, the potluck after church today, so we'll keep it short. Trust me. I don't need to get whacked from behind. We have choir practice tonight at 6 o'clock, praise group tomorrow at 7. And, of course, on Wednesday we have the Lenten Bible studies both at 10 a.m. and at 6:30. And we have the Lenten candles, and we extinguish one each week. And hopefully that will remind us to be closer to God. And, of course, Caitlin, we're doing T-shirts again and sweatshirts. Anything to say about that? Oh.
They're online. The order form is online. They've been in the email. They've also been shared on the Facebook. If you would like a shirt or a sweatshirt and you do not order online, because I know some people do not, get in touch with us and we will either help you order online or we will collect a big order and put them online.
And for the procrastinators in the group, the deadline is?
The 23rd of March.
Which is? So it's coming up quick. So make sure you get the order in. And we have a couple of numbers we have to get, right, in order to get the order. So we still have many to go.
Many to go.
So get those orders in if you can. And now we turn our attention to those who need some special prayer.
Larry, can I pop this
on? No worries. Other announcements.
Yes. So the plates in the back of the church today are a special offering to support the after prom, the drug and alcohol-free after prom for the local school. So please, as you're able, consider donating to that. And again, there'll be the plates are in the back of the church. They'll be there till the end of the service. And then in 2 weeks from today, we will start with our Easter offering that will run the 2nd and 9th of April. But also, 2nd of April is Palm Sunday. So we are looking for children. So if you're interested in helping us bring in the palms, please come for the 11 o'clock service. And actually, while you're at it, come for the 10 o'clock service and enjoy Sunday school too. So that's what's going on the next couple of weeks.
That's and awesome. That's awesome. I'm sorry. Any other announcements? All right, seeing none, we'll move on to our prayer list, which is entirely too long. We need to be praying harder, it looks like. We did have one name, family of Jane Wax, and we added this morning. Any other names for the prayer list?
I put Bob Brown on that.
Bob Brown. Yep. Okay, after our meditation and prayer, our communion hymn will be number 460.
Shepherd, we depend.
depend on you for everything we need, for daily food, for guidance, for protection, for healing and injury, and comfort and sorrow. You respond in abundant provision, and we give you thanks. Thank you for your tender care of us. Thank you for soothing the wounds of this life. Thank you that in the presence of enemies, especially the last enemy of death, you are with us as shepherd, host. Knowing your faithfulness in our lives, we bring before you the lives of others, the cares of this world, entrusting all things to your goodness and mercy. Lord, listen to our silent prayers this morning. Bring healing to those who are ill in mind, body, or spirit. Bring release to those who are held captive by old hurts or new bonds that oppress and entangle. We pray this morning for those on our prayer list and for the names that we have added. You know them so well, Lord. You created them and you know their very needs. And we ask this morning for you to touch them with healing, touch them with comfort, and touch them with peace. Lord, bring freedom to those unjustly accused, relief to those who are burdened with debt, comfort to all those who suffer from abuse of any kind. We pray for people living in the midst of war. We pray for those in Ukraine. We pray for the soldiers in Russia. We pray and ask for you to protect our citizens and our soldiers alike, and to teach us to put away our weapons, to take up instead what you call us to do, to take up instead words of peace and reconciliation, no matter where we are in this world. By the power at work in Christ, break down the walls of hostility we build so that we may learn to live together graciously. Lord, compel us to be better stewards of creation so that our habitation is sustainable and responsible. Loving God, help us to see the world as you see it, to see others as you see them, and to see ourselves rightly too. Because you have come into this world for judgment, we can leave our judgments behind. Pursue us all with your goodness and faithful love, until goodness and faithful love fills every heart and informs every action. We pray the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning to the Lord's table. Ordinary bread made by ordinary people is holy when we take and eat and remember. Ordinary grace taken by ordinary people and made into ordinary wine are holy when we hold the wine to our lips and remember and drink this bread. Remember his body was given for us. This wine, remember his blood was poured out for us. Bread and wine, from ordinary to holy. Let us remember. Our hymn of communion is on page 260. Let us break bread. Thank you.
we're thankful again for the opportunity to have to pause before your table. We're thankful for this opportunity that we have to take communion together. Help us as we commune today to lay the cares of this world aside so that we may hear your small voice speaking to us and in hearing, listen. Help us to leave this place doing your will in today's world. We ask that you bless this loaf, which represents your broken body.
And dear Father, as we gather around this communion table this morning, we ask that you bless this cup. And may as we let go of all those little things that we hold dear and near to us, that those anxious moments and all those things that we need to let go of and let them go to you. May we let them go to you, and may we, as we gather around this cup today, may you actually fill our cup, fill us up till we're whole. In your name we pray. Amen.
On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it. And he said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you." And likewise, he took the cup. And after supper, he said, "Take, drink, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of your sins." And then he said this, "I will not partake of the fruit of the vine again until that day I do so again with you." These are the gifts of God for each one of us. Let us partake together after you've been served. Thank you.
pray. Thank you, Father, thank you for the opportunity to have to share a portion of our gifts with you. We ask that you bless both the gift and the giver and the mission on which they go. We ask in his name. Amen.
I see a minister, and then he became a missionary. clover, but same difference, in the same family, okay? So one of St. Patrick's legends is that he taught the people of Ireland about the Trinity. Y'all know what that is? Have y'all ever heard them say, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost? That's all three. That's all three things that we call God, right? So we're calling God as the Father. Who's the Son? What name do we use? Jesus. And Holy Spirit is just Holy Spirit, right? So he used this little shamrock with its three leaves to explain to the Irish people that those three are the same person. So you have three individual leaves, right, on your shamrock? But how many stems do you have? One. They're all the same. So when we think of St. Patrick's Day, we're not thinking about the four-leaf clover. We're thinking about the three-leaf and what it means. Okay? All right. I have on each a little paper to tell you that, so that you have the color. One of each. Yeah, you can get my paper. We'll see if Luigi lets you keep it. You can use it to explain to somebody that wasn't here. How about that? Plus, we have lots. We have the bulletin. And if you need a pack of cracker, crayon, not cracker. Sorry. Moved on to the meal. Get you some right out of this bag. All right. Do you need crayons? No. I'm afraid of what you do with crayons. Thank y'all for coming.
Favored by music? By the praise group.
Thank you.
gospel reading this morning is in the Gospel of John. And we are in John 9, verses 1 through 41, if you would like to follow along in your pew Bibles, or if you would like to follow on the screen. Listen to the Word of God. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened?" He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, but the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but for as this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "This is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes." We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind? If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, you were born entirely in sin, and you're trying to teach us? And he drove him out. Jesus heard they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, surely we are not blind, are we? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say we see, your sin remains. May God bless the reading and hearing of God's holy word. Would you please pray with me? Almighty, gracious, loving God, may the words of my mouth be acceptable unto you, and may the meditations be awesome. Grace Leary was a wise and gracious woman. She was a peacemaker who thirsted and hungered for the kind of life in which she believed that Jesus calls us to. And she was a member of Snowville Christian Church in Snowville, Virginia, which is in Pulaski County, a small village outside of Radford. She was a member of the church that Jonathan served. In addition to operating a small business with her husband, Grace spent many years rehabilitating men and women in the prison system. And unfortunately, Grace had some medical problems in life, and she has since passed. But I remember one particular time I spoke with Grace one Sunday afternoon after a special church service. It was after she was released from a rehabilitation hospital, and Grace shared with me one of her experiences there. And she said there was a woman in a wheelchair that always parked her chair near the front of the nursing station. If you've ever spent time in a nursing home, you have seen it. No one hardly said a word to her. Maybe assuming her faculties were no longer there. And one day, Grace said that she went up to her and talked with her. And the next day, she said she did it again. And one day, this woman asked me what the word affinity meant, and I told her. And the next day, she asked me about another complicated word. And then each day after that, another complicated word. And after about 5 days, Grace's new companion shared that she has been feeling depressed. And Grace said to her new friend, and told me that she knew more about depression than any professor that she ever encountered, because she had firsthand knowledge of what it felt to feel invisible. But Grace saw her. Grace offered her new friend the light of Christ. Grace took the light of Christ embodied within her, accompanied by the gifts and graces, which was her warm smile, her calming presence, her patience, that God embodied Grace with, as proof that Jesus is still using believers to help those who have been forgotten or for those who are living in the dark. Did others in the nursing home even notice what was transpiring? You would have had to have been made blind. One would have had to have disregarded their earthly eyes to have seen it. And this is what Jesus is asking of us. The Gospel of John is divided into two parts. The first part, chapters 1 through 12, is commonly referred to as the Book of Signs. And chapters 13 through 20 are commonly referred to as the Book of Glory. So since this passage, the miracle story of the blind beggar is located in the Book of Signs, then we must determine what the sign is that Jesus wants the people to see. Furthermore, scholars believe that the story of Jesus as the Good Shepherd must accompany our story also, because John does not offer us a break between stories. Jesus is near the temple. He is accompanied by his disciples, and all of his disciples are able-bodied. They can see, they can hear, they are mobile. The Pharisees are able-bodied in terms of seeing and hearing and mobility. The blind beggar's parents were able-bodied in terms of seeing, hearing, and mobility. And among them, there was one person in this story that was blind, the blind beggar. And the scripture tells us that Jesus came into the world for judgment so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. And I understand our reluctance or willingness to trust. About 15 years ago, I directed a literacy program in Christiansburg, and one of our biggest fundraisers was an annual book sale at the Christiansburg Mall. And each year, many volunteers, even players from the Virginia Tech football team, the men and women's basketball team would carry thousands of books in the mall each year. It was hard work. We still remember those days. But one year, I asked Jonathan who he might know that could help. And he said, well, there's Tommy. He can collect the money and check folks out. And Tommy was a great friend to the two of us. He ran the coffee shop at the hospital. But Tommy was blind. And I couldn't wrap my brain around how Tommy would be able to take folks' money and make change. But Jonathan insisted that he could do it. So I agreed. On the first day that Tommy volunteered, I ran over to watch him make change. Because I had to see to believe that our biblical story this morning, Jesus is calling the people to believe in things they cannot see, but yet believe in miracles performed by him. To believe that what some believe might be impossible is made possible. The Pharisees could not believe that a man in human form could possibly perform a miracle such as this. Only God can do miracles. In fact, in Jesus' time, the Pharisees taught that anyone born without eyesight, God made blind because their parents sinned. The disciples began with that question, right? Jesus, who sinned? The man or his parents? Jesus calls us to take off our earthly glasses and to replace them with glasses that look beyond what we see at first glance. And instead, look at things the way that Jesus calls us, to have faith in what he is doing, regardless of whether we see the action and whether we see the mystery of it ourselves. Jesus calls us to become blind, to close our eyes so we can see and feel from our heart the work that Jesus is doing among us. to replace our darkness, our fears, our disbelief with light, which is translated as hope, isn't it? At the Sea of Galilee, there are warning signs at the shoreline's parking lot. And the area is prone to sudden storms and vicious waves, but despite the signs, every so often, a storm would boil and swamp a car or two. They're not heeding the signs. In the feeding of the 5,000, we witness another impossible, hard-to-miss sign of Jesus' mission and authority. Many wanted to make Jesus king on the spot, but Jesus said no. The crowds have seen the sign, but yet have missed the fullness of Jesus' mission. How can we take the signs of Jesus' work in the world beyond face value? How do we heed their deeper meaning and calls to discipleship? Jesus began building the case of his mission, of peace and love from the beginning. And this story, this miracle story, took place 2,000 years ago. And Jesus continues to redeem the world through you and me with the light that he has left us, through the power of the Holy Spirit that he has left us. Praise God. But many of us are still reluctant to let go and let God steer the wheel of our life. We feel that we need to be the ruler of our life, right? And we remain reluctant at times to believe that whatever shape we believe the world to be in, that God is still in control. The blind man did not blink when Jesus called him to go into the waters. He was called for that moment. Unlike the similar story in 2 Kings 5 and the prophet Elijah called Naaman, the king of Syria, to go into the Jordan River and be cured of leprosy. Do you remember that story? Naaman's family had to push him almost into the water because he would not go to be washed 7 times, to be clean, to be healed of leprosy. Are we more during this time of Lent? Are we more like this unnamed blind man, ready to serve and ready to live out the purpose that God has for us, for what we are called to do? Or are we like Naaman, digging our heels in and saying, "Whoa, Jesus, I am too afraid. I'm too afraid to trust in you today." And are we reluctant to look at the good rather than the Jesus tells his disciples in this story that this man was born blind for a purpose. He was born blind for this moment to be one more sign of who Jesus is prior to his crucifixion and resurrection. This healing is a proclamation that Jesus came from heaven, that he is the Messiah, the one that saves. And that, too, is how we are called to live. What is your purpose? And will you give Jesus permission to use what God has equipped you with to further his mission? The Apostle Paul writes to the church in Rome in Romans 15. And he writes, looking back, writing to the first church in Rome, looking back over what has been accomplished, Paul writes, and what I have observed, I must say I am most pleased. This is the Message translation. I'd even say proud, but only in that context, for I have no interest in giving you a chatty account of my adventures, but only the wondrously powerful and transformingly present words and deeds of Christ in me that triggered a believing response among the outsiders. In such ways I have trailblazed and preaching the message of Jesus all the way from Jerusalem far into northwestern Greece. And this has been all pioneer work, bringing the message only into those places where Jesus was not yet known and worshipped. My text has been, writes Paul, those who were never told of him, they'll see him. And those who've never heard of him, they'll get the message. God is redeeming us, transforming the world day by day. And it might feel slow. We get discouraged when we read the horrific things that happen in our modern day world. But Jesus insists that we who are physically able must not look at this world only through earthly eyes, but open them to what God is doing in the world every day. We can't take mud and spit and perform miracles. But when we and those we encounter invite and share Jesus with others, light will enter. And the world will once again be witness to the signs of his glory once again. When we behave like Jesus, and like Grace, and like all the other saints in our midst, the world invariably will look different. Auntie Niles, an expert in evangelism, speaks about evangelism as witness. And he writes that evangelism is witness. It is one beggar telling another beggar where to get food. The Christian does not offer out of his own bounty, for he has no bounty. He is simply guest at his master's table, and as evangelist, he calls others too. Grace gave not out of her bounty, but out of Christ. This morning's message is about Jesus being intentional on what he is offering the world. And for us to believe that we have that gifts in ourselves and in others. And this is Jesus' pitch. Lightness versus darkness. Faith versus despair. To believe in Jesus as Lord and Savior, to believe he is the Messiah, the one that has come to save us, to live by faith in the power of Jesus to do miracles, even when we cannot see the end result, to know that God got this, to know that Jesus is the Good Shepherd, watching and tending to his flock, to know and see that God is working among us, to know and see that you have been gifted with what the world needs. To point to signs of hope and help those who are blind but yet can physically see. To see and believe in the power of Jesus. Amen. Our hymn of invitation is on page 343. If you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you would like to make that public affirmation and that declaration this morning, we invite you. If you are not a member of Perseverance Christian Church and you would like to be a part of this beloved community, we invite you to come forward during our last hymn. Would you please rise for hymn number 343, Amazing Jesus. also wore green, an additional day. So after the benediction, then I will give a prayer for the food. Let us pray. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace of believing, so you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, mighty, gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity to be in fellowship. We ask you to bless the food to the nourishment of our body so we can continue to serve you. We ask for a blessing upon the hands that prepare it, and we ask for a blessing upon those who partake it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
That's it.